Today we are going to share on a different topic along the same line of thought, and that is greater glory after adversity. Greater glory after adversity. Shall we pray? Father, in the name of Jesus, I want to thank you for this day that you brought us to your house. And as we gather, Lord of heaven, as we pray so long, my Father, we pray that you be glorified in everything that we do, be glorified in everything that we say, because we are in your house, O God. We believe, Jehovah, that when we are in your house, it is not in vain that we have gathered, O dear Savior. Lord of heaven, lift our spirits, O dear Savior, encourage us, O Lord, strengthen us, O dear Father, even in time of adversity, even as we focus on your glory, O my King of glory, the glory that is in your house. In the name of Jesus, we pray and believe. Amen. Amen. Today, as I said, we are going to share on another topic along the same line of thought, greater glory after adversity. And I want to invite you to read with me from our main text, that is the book of Haggai, chapter 2, verse 1 to 9, from the New American Standard Bible. And I'm going to read from verse 1. On the 21st of the 7th month, the word of God came by Haggai the prophet, saying, "Speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, to Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people, saying, Who is left among you who saw the temple in its former glory? And how do you see it now? Does it not seem to you like nothing in comparison?" Verse 4. "But now take courage, Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Take courage also, Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and all you people of the land. Take courage, declares the Lord, and work. For I am with you, declares the Lord of hosts." Verse 5. "As for the promise I made with you when you came out of Egypt, my spirit is abiding in your midst. Do not fear." Verse 6. "For thus says the Lord of hosts, Once more, in a little while, I'm going to shake the heavens and the earth, the sea also and the dry land. I will shake all the nations, and they will come with the wealth of all nations. And I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, declares the Lord of hosts. Verse 9. The latter glory of this house will be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, declares the Lord of hosts. I go over verse 9 again. The latter glory of this house will be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, declares the Lord of hosts. And may God bless his word. As an introduction, I want to tell you that Haggai is used by God to speak to the people of Judah, and at this time he is calling on the remnant people of Judah and to make a comparison between the current state of the temple of God that is in Jerusalem and its original state as was built by Solomon the king. Solomon had built a temple that was magnificent, that was beautiful, it was a state of art, and it was expensive, and so to say, it was glorious in all aspects. If we look at 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 1 to 2, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 1 to 2, we'll see an account. We pull out something there from an account of what happened after Solomon had built the temple and what he did. And verse 7 says, now when Solomon had finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and sacrifice. And the glory of God filled the house. The priests could not enter into the house of the Lord because of the glory of God that had filled the Lord's house. Our greatest desire in our time is to have such an experience of a heavenly visitation, the so-called Shekinah glory. This is what happened when Solomon had done a prayer of dedication of the temple. Then, in such an experience or such a visitation, we will see that our sacrifices will be accepted by God. Such manifestation of God's presence authenticates and validates our gathering or our meetings. It did happen during Solomon's time when he dedicated the temple. If it can happen in our time, it will happen in our time in Jesus' name. After Solomon completed building the temple, which was really a lot of work, it was quite expensive in terms of time and resources that were used. And you may recall that his father David also participated, though in the background, in supporting the building of the temple by gathering the material for the building of the temple. But Solomon is the one that was used by God to build the temple of God. After now he completed building the temple of God, he dedicated it to God. He had a ceremony of dedication, and there is much that was done during that dedication of the temple. One of the major things that were done was the sacrifices and offerings that were given, and now the prayer. When he completed the dedication prayer, the glory of God filled the temple so much that the priests could not enter there and minister as usual. This temple was glorious in two critical aspects. One of them is in its outlook, the architecture, the work, the artwork, how it was done. It was marvelous. There has been no such a temple that has ever existed there before. Nobody is able to match Solomon's one piece of work. The other aspect was God's presence. The temple was glorious also in terms of God's presence. The Bible says that there was the glory of God that came down after the sacrifices were done, the offerings were done, and the prayer of dedication was done, and that is the Shekinah glory. Here we see something, that giving, prayer and giving, will usher in the glory of God. That in our worship, we need to pray, and we also need to give, and then the presence of God will come. Because you hear that the sacrifice that was done on that day, it was a great budget that was done for that dedication ceremony. And then the prayer that was offered, then the glory of God filled the temple. The great temple that was built by Solomon stood in position for 410 years. 410 years. But around 587 BC, King Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, captured Jerusalem as a city and burned the whole city. And also, along with burning the whole city, he destroyed the temple completely. Among the remnants that were in exile, the remnants of Judah, there could just be but a few people that could reconnect or could remember the glory that was there in the temple before its destruction. And from this call by Haggai, we can have a comparison. We are going to do a comparison between the comparison that is being done with our current situation as a church. Now, in this comparison, we are going to draw two parallels. The first parallel that we are going to draw is what is happening to the Church of Jesus Christ today. In our nation, and in many nations of the world, the churches are in trouble. The churches are in a bad state. And I want to ask, as Prophet Haggai is being used by God to ask the people of Judah, can you remember how good it was when we could gather together every Sunday for worship? Can you remember how refreshing, how good and wonderful it was as saints could gather in the church every Sunday? How then does it compare with the current so-called online services? How does it compare? We are really struggling to reach out to people. We are struggling to connect with the people with the word of God. How does this compare? There are no morning devotions. There are no intercessory prayers. There are no praise and worship, those refreshing moments of praise and worship. No choir, no children ministering in the church, no midweek meetings, fellowship. How does it compare? And I ask, who remembers those moments? Those glorious moments when we used to gather together as saints and share together the word of God with Christ at the center of our worship. Is it anywhere near what we used to have? What we are having today, does it really compare? This is what Prophet Haggai is asking in verse 3. This is what he is asking. Who is left among you? Who saw the temple in its former glory? And how do you see it now? Does it seem to you like nothing? Does it not seem to you like nothing in comparison? So that is the first parallel that we are making with what is happening in our situation today. That it is not where in comparison. What we are having today is nowhere in comparison with what we used to have when we used to have physical gathering of saints in Jesus' name. It is not in anywhere near. It is not anywhere near. It is totally different. The second parallel that we are going to draw is from the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. In the day after death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, I mean during the death of Christ, he was crucified and everything happened, he was buried, and then later he resurrected. There is something that we are going to learn after his resurrection. Something did happen. There were two brethren that were traveling to Emmaus. And they were discussing about what had happened in Jerusalem. And as they were going, we read this from Luke chapter 24, verse 13 to 32. As they were going on their way to Emmaus, they were joined by a stranger. And a stranger was inquiring about their conversation. He wanted to intrude in their conversation. And as they were joined by the stranger, this is what the stranger said in verse 17. We go to verse 17. And he is Jesus, and he said to them, what are these words that you are exchanging with one another as you are walking? And they stood still, looking sad. One of them, named Cleopas, answered to him and said, are you the only one visiting Jerusalem and unaware of the things which have happened here in these days? And he said to them, what things? And they said to him, the things about Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet, mighty indeed and word, and in the sight of God and all people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to the sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, it is the third day since these things happened. As they were discussing, you see somebody joins them, a stranger joins them, and starts inquiring about their conversation. And now they are narrating their predicament, the situation in which they are. They are remembering the glory of Christ before he died. And they are also recalling how he was molested and how he was crucified and how he is in the grave. And it is the third day since these things happened. Now, as Babylonians destroyed the temple in Jerusalem, when Nebuchadnezzar captured the city of Jerusalem in 587 BC, so was Christ also arrested and tortured in Jerusalem 600 years later and crucified and buried in the tomb. The two brethren are going to Emmaus and are wondering how their new companion or their new visitor or the person who has just joined them on their journey does not know what has happened in Jerusalem. They are wondering how come he cannot, he doesn't understand and he's inquiring. How Christ was bruised, how Christ was tortured, how he was covered with blood all over, and how finally they led him to the tomb. His appearance during the crucifixion and burial could not in any way compare with how he was before. There was no comparison. Christ was healing people. Christ did many miracles. And he was going from place to place. And even during the triumphant entry to Jerusalem, he was glorious. It was a glorious moment when they all sang Hosanna, Hosanna to the one who comes in the name of the Lord. And they laid palm trees for him on the road. It was a glorious moment when Christ entered Jerusalem. And shortly after that, he was arrested, he was tortured, and he was crucified and buried. Now these two brethren are discussing the former state and the current state. They are saying now he is in the grave. And it is the third day since these things happened. There is no comparison. With the two parents that we have grown, we can look at what God is actually promising. In Haggai, the same chapter that we read, Haggai chapter 2, verse 7 to 9, God promises something good. He is promising greater glory for the latter house. Praise be to the name of Jesus. He speaks of both outlook and God's presence. Glory speaks about outlook and God's presence. Don't miss out on that. Because he says also that my presence will abide with you. In verse 5 of Haggai chapter 2, he says, my presence will abide with you. In our case, it speaks of revival of the church. I am convinced more than ever before that there will be a revival. After all this adversity, there will be a revival of the Church of Jesus Christ. The church services are going to be more vibrant than ever before in the name of Jesus. Before the churches were closed due to the COVID-19, the churches are going to be more glorious. There will be more vibrance in the church. God's promises are true and amen. And I am standing on the promises of God to tell you, church, and to tell you, my brother and my sister, that the glory of the church will be greater than the former. Though we are saying it was wonderful when we gathered together, it was great when we worshiped God together, those glorious moments, we remember them. Even in our current state, though we say it cannot compare, we remember what God used to do in our midst. But God is giving a promise here that the glory of the latter church shall be greater than the former. Glory be to the name of the Lord. And 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, that's where I stand on the promises of God. For as many as are the promises of God in him, they are yes, therefore, also through him is our amen to the glory of God. I go right again. For as many as are the promises of God in him, they are yes, therefore also through him is our amen to the glory of God the Father. What God has promised, what God promised Haggai, what God promised Haggai is also a promise to the church. Because the church was physically devastated that time. The temple was physically devastated and destroyed that time. But in our time, there can come certain form of devastation and certain types of destruction. But altogether, God is promising greater glory in the name of the Lord. What he has said he will accomplish, he will accomplish. What he has said he will do, he will do. But we have to respond to God's call accordingly and act. Now we see God raising Jesus Christ according to his promises with a glorified body, more glorified, on the third day after burial. This was in line with God's promises both in the New Testament, in the Old Testament, and the New Testament. Even the two brothers could not recognize the glorified Christ. They could not recognize him until he opened their eyes. Because the reason Christ was more glorified, God raised him with a different body rather than different than that with which he was buried. He was glorified. The reason Christ was glorified, hallelujah, he was greater. He had greater glory. This was the latter temple. The latter temple was more glorious until the two brethren could not identify him. I know we love to hear and even experience the coming revival. That is natural for the church to hear and to love to experience the coming revival. But there is a precursor to revival. A precursor to revival. Now, at times, revivals are preceded by moments of testing and suffering and persecution. We learned last Sunday that after darkness comes light. That is an assurance that after darkness, after moments of darkness, comes light. Today, the church is closed. It is like we are in exile. Christians are in exile in their own homes. We are always being reminded to stay at home, stay in exile. We are in exile in our own homes, just as the people of Judah were in exile. And although this has happened, and we cannot go to church, this is a kind of a testing fire for the church of Jesus Christ. It is a testing fire. Some pastors have even said that this is the time you will be able to know the genuine members of the church, the people who are really genuine, of which I totally agree. Isaiah chapter 48 verse 10, this is what God says. I have purified you with fire, not as silver, not as silver, but I have purified you with fire. Fire is painful. The fire of church closure is painful. Very painful to all members and very painful to the pastors especially. But we are also seeing God is speaking to leaders here. He is speaking to Zerubbabel, who was the governor. He is also speaking to Joshua, who was the priest. These were the leaders of the time. It was painful for them. But also, he is speaking to all the people of Judah, the remnant. So, God is speaking to the pastors. He is also speaking to us. And we need to know that this is a moment of testing for the church. But now Isaiah says, I have purified you with fire. Fire is painful. This fire is really painful. But although it is that painful, it purifies precious materials and removes impurities. I hope you will not be part of the impurities to be removed as the fire goes out. May God help you. May God help me also. That as the fire goes out, none of us will be removed from the precious materials. Church, the church is precious. The church is an example of a precious material. And we are purchasing the precious blood of Jesus. And some of us may have to fall on the wayside during the fire of testing. But may God help all of us that we may be refined by this fire. Because the purpose of the fire is to refine. But also, there is a byproduct of the refining. And those are the impurities. There are two important things that you need to know during testing. And one of the things that you need to know is endurance. James chapter 1 verse 12, and I read from Holman's Christian Standard Bible, James chapter 1 verse 12. A man who endures trials is blessed, because when he passes the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. I go back again. A man who endures trials is blessed, because when he passes the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. Brethren, we have to endure during this time. We have to endure the moment of testing if we have to achieve greater glory.
And during the time of to show that we are enduring, it means that we have to remain Christian, stronger than ever before, and seeking God more than ever before. That's one thing that we need to learn. And we shall be blessed. Those who do not endure cannot receive this blessing of the crown of life. The second thing that you need to know is assurance. And in this, I will give you three assurances. There are three assurances that we get. So the second thing you need to know is that God has given us an assurance. The first one is that we have to endure. Then the second thing that you need to know during the time of testing is that God is giving us assurance or assurances. And the first assurance we get from Romans chapter 8, verse 28, and I read from the New American Standard Bible. And we know that God causes all things to work together for the good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. Amen. I feel like going over it again. And we know that God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love God and to those who are called according to his purposes. Are you called according to God's purposes? If so, then all things will work together for your good. Even this testing fire, it will work together. Though it is painful, it will work together for the good of the church. The church is called according to the purpose of God. And therefore the question also is, are you part of the church of Jesus Christ? It will work together for the church. How? To bring greater glory in Jesus' name. That the pain we are experiencing today, the struggles we are experiencing today, will work together for the good of the church to bring greater glory in the name of the Lord. The second assurance is that pain of testing is less than the greater glory that is to come. And we get this from Romans chapter 8, verse 18, from the New American Standard Bible. For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Hallelujah. For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us in Jesus' name. Glory be to the name of the Lord. Therefore, we see that the pain of testing is much less in comparison with the glory, the magnitude of the glory that we are going to receive after the testing. Paul looks ahead to the blessed hope and the glory therein and sees it to be far beyond the current pain or the current inconveniences. Therefore, he determines to soldier on the journey. And he says that the suffering of this present time cannot of testing is less than the glory that we are to receive. The third assurance is that the pain of testing is seasonal. The pain of testing, my brother and my sister, is seasonal. Psalms chapter 30, verse 5. And I read from the New American Standard Bible again. For his anger is but for a moment. His favor is for a little time. Mark this. Weeping may last for a night, but a shout of joy comes in the morning. I repeat the last phrase. Weeping may last for a night, but the shout of joy comes in the morning. Hallelujah. Testing is seasonal, my brother and my sister. Suffering is seasonal. Weeping is seasonal. Moments of inconveniences are seasonal. Even in your individual life, just know this for sure, that all these things are seasonal. We learned last time that God will not allow the scepter of wickedness to rest upon the land of the righteous forever, so that the righteous may not stretch forth their hand into evil. Therefore, we know that these things are seasonal. Pain is seasonal. Church closure is seasonal. And therefore, we can endure because we know that we have assurance. Glory be to the name of the Lord. We are assured by God. These all are seasonal. But joy and glory and greatness will come in the morning. Praise be to the name of the Lord. The three assurances help us to endure even more. We are called upon to endure, but we are also given assurances. And the three assurances help us to endure even more as we wait for the greater glory in Jesus' name. But now, we have to heed God's call because God is making a call. I said that for the greater glory to come, then we have to respond accordingly to God's call. Now, heeding God's call, brethren, there will be greater glory for the church. That's an assurance. And we have said that as many as are the promises of God, they are yes. And to us a resounding amen to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, the greater glory that is promised is surely going to come in Jesus' name for the church of Jesus Christ. There will also be greater glory for individuals and families in Jesus' name. God promised Haggai that he's going to shake the nations and he will bring the money of the nations, all the money of the nations to the temple, because silver and gold belong to God. So he will cause them to bring the resources for putting up the new temple in Jerusalem. And he says that he had shaken the world there before, but he will shake it again. And he will cause the nations to come and bring the wealth, the money to put up the temple. That is the more glorious temple in outlook in Jesus' name. This will happen to all those who will heed God's call to Zerubbabel and to Joshua, son of Jehozadak. This is what will happen to all those who will heed that call. Now we need to know what was the call. What is God calling them to do? God is calling Zerubbabel and Joshua and all the people of Judah to take courage and work. Take courage and work. And we get this in verse 4. If we go to verse 4 of what we just read, we see God is telling them, take courage and work. That is the call that he's giving. But now, take courage, Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Take courage also, Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest. And all of the people of the land, take courage, declares the Lord. And work, for I am with you, declares the Lord of hosts. Praise be to the name of the Lord. That is what God is doing. He is giving a call unto us to take courage and work. During this time of adversity, we are called upon to be more courageous, not to be moved by adversity, not to be moved by trials, not to be moved by the testing, not to be moved by the fire of testing, but to take courage, to be courageous and declare the word of God. And not only that, but we also engage in work. That we work harder for the church, we work harder for God, we work harder for our families in the name of the Lord. Even our families and individuals will be more glorious only if we respond to God's call. We said last time that this is not the time to hide under the cover of darkness and fail to worship God and fail to serve God. But this is the time that we need to engage even more, because we know that revival is coming. We know that glory is coming. Better glory, greater glory is coming. As Jesus Christ was raised with a different glorious body, then we know that glorious moments are coming. More glorious moments are coming. And therefore we need to work and work harder in the name of the Lord. In conclusion, my brother and my sister, respond to God's call, even as the purifying fire rests in our time. Work hard and work smart, as much as you can. In your job, in your business, wherever you are, do not squander any energy or time available to you to work, but work hard. Work hard in prayer. Work hard in reading God's word. Work hard in giving faithfully and generously to God's work at this time. Revival is coming. Take courage. Even as you prepare for the greater coming glory, do not take a holiday. Don't be in holiday. Rise and work. Revival is coming. Build capacity for revival. Re-establish and reinforce family altar. Rekindle the fire in your life as an individual. Rekindle the fire even in the family. And when we come back, I tell you, my brethren, it will be a great explosion to the glory of God the Father. Greater glory in Jesus' name. What are you doing to prepare for revival, my brother and my sister? How are you utilizing this window to prepare for greater glory? What are you doing, my sister? What are you doing, my brother? Glory is like a garment. Greater glory is a new garment. Who was to shower When we are preparing to wear a clean garment and a new garment, what do? We go to shower, we go to prepare. And I want to ask you, my brother and my sister, are you taking a spiritual shower? Are you preparing yourself for greater glory and for revival in Jesus' name? Some of you are going to minister at higher levels because of the glory that will be in the house. I want us to engage in prayer in Jesus' name. In response to the word of God, I want us to engage in prayer. Truly God is glorious and is going to give us this glory in Jesus' name. We are going to pray, my brother and my sister, we are going to pray with you that God will help us to heed God's call to Zerubbabel and to Joshua. And the call is to take courage and to work. That God will give us capacity for greater glory in the latter days, for the church, for our families, and for us as individuals. We are going to pray that we are going to be prepared for the revival. We are going to pray for grace, that God will give us grace to wait patiently during this time of adversity. We are going to pray for people among us who during this fire of testing may have been sick, those who are hungry, those who are lacking house rent, and those who are suffering, knowing surely that this is just for a moment. Later we are going to give thanks, we are going to make more prayer, and then we'll wind up. So we start by prayer in Jesus' name. And I want to ask you from your houses, wherever you are seated, bow in prayer in adoration to God. This is a moment of worshiping God. This is a moment of talking to God. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we want to thank you for the message that you gave Haggai. Dear Father, today to tell Zerubbabel and Joshua, the priest, oh Father, and to all the people of Judah, that Father, Lord of heaven, though the temple was devastated by Nebuchadnezzar, and Lord of heaven, it appeared nothing in comparison with the former temple, that you promised greater glory in the latter days, that Father, you are going to cause nations to bring them with their wealth, so that a more glorious temple is going to be put up, even as your servant Solomon had done. Now I pray in the name of the Lord that you are going to help brethren, O dear Father, at this time. You are going to help the church to hear this call, O dear Savior, that you gave to Zerubbabel the governor and Joshua the priest, that they should take courage and work. I pray in the name of the Lord that you are going to help every believer, every member of the church, that they are going to engage in serious work, in serious prayer and intercession, in reading your word, in committing their finances, in committing their resources to the work, to your work, O God. Because Jehovah, you have promised that your glory and your presence will continue to be with us, and you told the Zerubbabel not to fear. Therefore, I pray in the name of the Lord that brethren are not going to be covered and cowed down under fear in the name of the Lord, but you will help each and every one of them to take courage and work for you, even during adversity, in the name of the Lord Jesus. I pray for greater capacity. Help us to build capacity, even for the coming greater glory, for the church and for our families, and even for individuals, that my Father will be able to contain that greater glory that you are bringing to us, in the name of the Lord. I pray in the name of the Lord that you help all of us to prepare for revival, because revival is surely coming, because your word has said, as many as the promises of God, they are yes and amen. And therefore help us, O dear Savior, that we not fall on the wayside, but we shall be prepared for the revival, to contain the revival, to continue the new wine of revival, revival for the church, in the name of the Lord Jesus. We thank you, Father. Give us the grace to wait, O Lord. We are just but human beings, my Father, and often we get tired, O dear Lord. We often give up, but I pray in the name of the Lord that you give us the grace. I pray for more grace for my brother. I pray for more grace for my sister to wait upon you, dear Lord, to wait those refreshing moments, to wait those times of greater glory in the name of the Lord. Jehovah Master, I also know that during this time of adversity, some of us may have fallen sick, not necessarily in the plague or the COVID-19, but also other ailments. But your word says that you healed all manner of diseases. diseases when you are in the world. And therefore I pray, dear Father, for my brother and my sister, that you stretch forth your mighty hand, and through the mercies of your Father, through your Son Jesus Christ, that you are going to heal in the name of the Lord. May everyone who is sick be healed in the name of the Lord. I know some of us, oh dear Savior, are suffering, oh dear Lord. They are hungry, they don't have enough money to buy food. But I pray, Jehovah Master, because you are the Lord our provider, that you provide for those who are hungry. Provide for them food, oh my God. You know that we depend on you as our source, as our original source. And therefore pray in the name of the Lord. Mobilize your agents to come to the aid of our brethren who are hungry today. Those who do not have money to pay their house rent. I commit them unto us, oh my Father, that miraculously, oh God, as you did provide for your children, even when they were in exile. I pray, dear Father, that you provide for your people. Some are not able to engage in business that work properly, but I pray in the name of the Lord that you will bless their work, oh God. The little hours they are going to put into their business is going to be blessed in the name of the Lord Jesus. Provide for your people in the name of the Lord. Those who are having any form of suffering, I pray for their uplifting. I pray for their help in the name of the Lord Jesus, that they will also take courage and work for you, even in preparation for the greater glory that is coming in the name of the Lord. I want us to pray now in terms of thanksgiving to God for the success we have had in the fight against COVID-19. We thank God for the 60 recoveries. It was reported we have 60 recoveries yesterday. And we also want to thank God for the rain that is there. Even as we also pray that it will not cause tragedy. That the rain that is there is helping our people so that they may have food, so that we may not have famine and plague at the same time. We want to thank God. We also want to thank God for the reduced infection rate that we have witnessed, and also thank God for the low mortality rate. I want us to engage in a prayer of thanksgiving to God. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you this time. Thank you, Father, Lord of heaven, for the success we have had so far in the fight against this plague, the COVID-19. We want to thank you for the 60 people that have recovered from the plague. We thank you, Jehovah, because it is you that has healed them, O God. And I pray, dear Jehovah, Lord of heaven, that we will continue getting more recoveries in Jesus' name. We want to thank you for showering our nation with rain, so that, dear Father, we may not have death or adversity. We already have the plague, my Father, and therefore you are sending rain to our land, so that, my Master, dear Savior, our people will have food to eat. You have said that you will also send rain to us when we call upon your name. You have already sent rain, O dear Savior. We thank you for the healing that is coming gradually, and we believe that you are going to speed it up in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We also pray, dear Jehovah, as the rains are coming, O dear Lord, you will stop the rain from causing havoc. That is not a God going to cause havoc in various areas, as we have witnessed in Kapenguria. We commit the people of Kapenguria into your hands. Those who have lost loved ones due to the flood, them at the floodline, my Father, you remember them and comfort them, O dear Lord, and stop further death in that place in the name of the Lord Jesus. We want to thank you for the reduced infection rate. We have seen, dear Father, Lord of heaven, it has been predicted that many people are going to be infected, but we have seen a slowdown. Therefore, we pray, Jehovah Master, that you will slow down even to an extent of stopping totally in the name of the Lord. We thank you for the low mortality rate in Kenya. Jehovah, you have served our nation. We know it could have been worse. But we thank you, dear Jehovah, that Lord of heaven, not many people are dying from this disease, because Jehovah, you are healing our land. We glorify your name. We thank you for everything good thing that you are doing. Even in this fight against the COVID-19, we know that you are the mighty God, and you are the Lord of war. You are going to fight with us, and you are going to fight for us in the name of the Lord. We thank you for our government, even as you give them, dear Father, them that have been entrusted even in that committee of fighting this disease. I pray in the name of the Lord that you give them greater wisdom to know what to do and what to direct the nation to do in the name of the Lord. We thank you and we appreciate you. In Jesus' name we pray. Now I want us to pray for more recoveries to happen, especially for the 190 active cases. Pray against the infection. Pray for the elderly in the community against the COVID-19, pray for immunity for people with other health conditions, that God will help them. Pray for mass healing before mass testing, and pray for all health workers,
and all involved in Jesus' name.
Father, in the name of Jesus, I want to thank you, dear Father, because of the healing that is taking place, the recovery that has taken place. Father, I pray that the 190 active cases that we have as of yesterday, you will speed and you will accelerate their healing in the name of the Lord Jesus. I believe you are able to do it and you will do it. I want to pray, oh dear Father, that as many as you will heal, they will not be infected as was witnessed in China. But my Father, that you heal and heal them completely in the name of the Lord. I want to commit our elderly people in our community, my Father, that Lord of heaven, you will boost your immunity in the name of Jesus Christ. It has been said that elderly people are dying in other nations. But I pray for our elderly people in this nation that Jehovah, you are going to boost their immunity to an extraordinary level so that they are not going to be infected in the name of the Lord. I pray, Jehovah, for those among our people that are having other health conditions, that Jehovah, Lord of heaven, their immunity will not be jeopardized and will not be compromised when COVID-19 comes knocking. But Jehovah, you use their immunity so that they may not die of this calamity, of this plague, in the name of the Lord Jesus. I want to pray, Jehovah, Lord of heaven, we have heard that there will be mass testing that is coming soon, dear Jehovah. Now I pray in the name of the Lord, remember this nation of Kenya and bring mass healing in the name of the Lord. When you think you are healing upon a nation, you heal everybody. And therefore I pray in the name of Jesus, stretch forth your hand, O my Father, for the believers and non-believers, heal them in the name of the Lord, ahead of the mass testing, so that when we engage in mass testing, we find healed people in the name of the Lord Jesus. I want to commit our health workers and your hands, O God, and all those who are involved, my Father, that you give them grace and protection during this time, O dear Savior. It is a very difficult time for them, but I know that you are doing something good for them in the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you for what you are doing, merciful God, because you are merciful to our nation, and we are going to see greater glory coming upon our people in the name of the Lord. And my Father, after all this is done, I pray that, dear Father, this greater revival that is coming, we'll see churches flocking with the people who have been saved. I believe, my Father, it will be a time of a harvest in the name of the Lord. We thank you and we appreciate you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As we wait up for service, we have heard that during the dedication of the temple, people gave, and they gave sacrifices, they gave offerings, and it was quite a bountiful giving. It was quite generous giving, and therefore I call upon you, my brother and my sister, during this type of adversity, that we give towards the work of God, because you have said we have to take courage and work. Part of working is giving towards the work of God, and therefore I want to pray for your offering, and I want to pray for your tithe in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of the Lord, we have our brethren who are giving their tithes and offerings through the M-Pesa. Jehovah Master, I pray that you bless them and do them good. As you bless the people that participated in the building of the temple in Jerusalem, I pray in the name of the Lord that you are going to bless every person who touches that phone and starts giving in, even to pay their tithe and even to give their offering and any other form of giving during this time of darkness. I pray in the name of the Lord that Jehovah, you are going to bless them, that you will preserve them during this time, and they will be part and parcel of the revival team that will be held the charge in the name of the Lord. I commit their families unto your hands, that you bless them also, God. If they are going through any difficulty, my Father, may you overcome for them in the name of the Lord. I thank you and I appreciate you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As you give your offering, I want to remind you that the number you are going to send to is given to you on the screen, 0703-186-284. 0703-186-284. And once you have done your giving, please specify what is your offering and what is your tithe or any other form of giving that you may have. God bless you and do you good even as you give your offering and your tithe, and as you take courage and work, because revival is coming, glory is coming, greater glory is coming in Jesus' name. We continue listening to this song, singing about the glorious God, because it's the glorious God who fills the temple with glory. As you listen to that song, we are going to say the words of benediction in Jesus' name. And now, to him who is able to do exceeding great, abundantly
you all we ask for things, according to the power that works within us, to him be glory in the church, and in Christ Jesus, to all generations, now and forevermore. Amen, amen. Shalom. God bless you. Amen. Amen.